This show is brought to you by Slice on Broadway, supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza, sliceonbroadway.com. And listeners like you, support this show at patreon.com/awesomecast. Hey guys, it's time to get geeky, talk tech. It is the AwesomeCast. I'm Mike Sorg at Sorgatron on the Twitter here in Mayhem Studios in Pittsburgh, PA. A very muggy Pittsburgh, PA. I need to stop talking about the weather on these things. But it's a very special edition. We got everybody in studio. Everybody. There's a new corner of the studio. It's revealed on video if you're with us.
She's in the library.
She's in the library. Yes,
she's
obviously.
In the room with you. I'm in a different room.
Obviously. So, of course, down the line, first of all, yes, over there in camera C, off by herself by the random stack of books somebody never took back, is Katie Dudas at KDudders on the Twitter.
Wait. Can you see my mic stand?
Yes, we're using Gonzo as an... Oh, you didn't see you decorated. It's very festive now.
I look very nice down here. Like, and I have all your presents.
Yes, you gave me gifts. There's a Star Wars trilogy on VHS. Oh, look, there's a wrestling book with Bill Goldberg.
And
a glass Faygo Red Pop. I promise not to throw that at anybody.
I do not.
Until the gathering, at least. Then that's just, you know, festive. Also with us, we got some friends on the couch. First, John Chichilla there on your right, chillatech.net.
How's it going?
And also with them, Ron Krause, Crazy Krause on the Twitter, who just unboxed his brand new Oculus Gear VR and put it on, and he's in virtual reality.
That's right.
He's like, give me all this real world.
How many multiplayer games are there where you can play more than two?
On the roof?
I know there's social medias
and stuff. There's social platforms, but I don't know enough about the games to get into it yet. But considering how many of us have them, by the way, I'm Sorgatron on the Oculus friends list. I just friended you, Chilla.
You did friend me. I can't remember what I put in as a name though.
I think it was just Chilla or something. You're in my contacts. Krause is on there. So I don't know if you've made your username yet or anything. So. But there's enough of us that we could definitely start experimenting with like the multiplayer games that they have on there. So it's been a pretty, like I said, Chachi got it as well. I'm hoping to get him on to get his impressions since he just completely, when he put that vibe on his head at the 6-year show, he just completely is like VR dude, VR, gotta do this. I gotta get a gear, You know, he got it like 2 days after I got the one from you. So, it's pretty interesting. So
I'm surprised to hear more and more people that are trying the Vive and actually saying they want the Vive over the Rift.
Oh, yeah.
Not just the gear, but I mean the Rift in general.
Oh yeah.
So it's, I think it's going to be an interesting run to continue to upgrade the platform and to get user adoption. Mm-hmm. I think it's going to change the way some people game and play.
And there's going to be so many other options between the PlayStation 1, which they just had a tour through town. I didn't get a chance to get out to it, or they were showing it off at GameStops and Best Buys. And, I just watched a video where they were talking about all the other headsets that are coming out. Starbreeze Studios, which I think is the one that got started by Vin Diesel, of all people, started their own one that has like a more of a wider angle of view. Because you don't really have peripheral vision on these things, right? You can turn your head, sure. But we'll get into that because we're going to have a little bit of VR talk here in a moment. But of course, this is your AwesomeCast, awesomecast.net. Subscribe to the show, share it with your friends. You can also check out the Awesome Chat where we periodically have some interviews with people around the area. Actually, our last interview we had on there was a couple weeks ago with Expogo, who's coming into town this week, I think July 8th and 9th. Go to expogo.com for information. It's out the Carry Furnaces. I'm hoping to get out to that and see a cool event in the Carry Furnaces. I think that'd be awesome enough on its own. Extreme Pogo is going to be a lot of fun. And of course, subscribe to the show on all the audio and video formats, including Facebook, including YouTube, iTunes, Stitcher, Spreaker, wherever you like to consume your content these days. Likely we're on it. And if we're not, let us know and we'll try to fix that for you. And please support us over at patreon.com/awesomecast, our good friends, Thistle C Business Development at Thistle C on the Twitter, and the Michael Fedor Show at Mike Fedor Show on Twitter as well. Thank you so much, executive producer level, the $5 level, supporting the show, keeping it independent. We're not, other than like the people that bring us pizza, we're not really seeking out a lot of sponsors or anything. We're hoping to keep this independent with you guys, and just tell you ways to support the show, support our friends, and hopefully that'll be it, and we can do the show and grow it that way. But we'll see.
We do a sad face with Gonzo. Please help us. We need another mic stand.
there you are.
There's your pitch.
There's your pitch. There's your pitch to help us on the Patreon as well. Well, let's get into it with the awesome things of the week. We're already starting to talk about it. So, Krause, let's talk a little bit about your new toy. You've only had just a few minutes in this thing already.
Yes, just a few moments.
And that's all. Is this the first VR you've got to experience? Have you tried like what are these before?
No, this is pretty much it. Yeah, I haven't even really seen his. We've talked at length about it, and that's what obviously enticed me to buy this when I found it on sale.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, so this is my first foray. As I was telling you before the show started, I had a friend at work ask me, so what are you going to do with this thing now that you bought it? And I'm like, well, not real sure yet. So it's going to be an adventure, you know, but it was one of those things where it was a price that I was willing to pay, and I figured, why not?
You know, I got to tell you, I was we were at our friend Fuzzy's house playing some games and you know, having barbecue and everything, and Chachi's there and our significant others, and I looked around and remember back in the day when you used to, like, you know, everybody kind of pulled out your phones, you saw like either the random Androids and mostly iPhones sitting on mm-hmm. the table, and in this instance, I noticed the all Samsung Edges happening. You know what I mean?
Really? Yeah.
Like, it's that prevalent. Like, anybody that's getting, like, once a decent phone is getting this. Like, it's becoming, I'm seeing as many Samsung Edges as I am iPhones, which also means this many people are under $100 away from virtual reality. Yeah. And I think that is the big turnaround here. And I think it'll be even bigger when, like maybe iPhone has one. I don't know. Maybe. Mm-hmm. But this is I think this is a really big turning point for this kind of thing.
Well, the what is the one from Google going to be called? Daydream?
Yeah, Daydream.
Daydream, they're saying that'll work with iPhone, but I actually was very impressed with the way Samsung did it to retrofit all of their devices all the way back, I think, to the S6. And then I'm sure it'll be forward into at least the next device. And if they continue to run deals where it's free with purchase of new device or discounted in certain circumstances, I could definitely see this catching on in mass.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that the reason for such a uptake in their device is the continued peripheral support with that, the wireless charger, Gear VR coming. I just think they have a very robust accessory market that keeps their people locked into that ecosystem. Unlike your HTCs and your Motorola's and the quality. I mean, you look at what Durda said about being in and having the Motorola and not realizing what he was missing on the other side with camera quality. So I'm pretty impressed with their products, and I think they're just going to continue to keep innovating.
I feel like they're out Appling Apple at this mm-hmm. point, and they're creating something exciting here. If only their keynotes weren't as questionable and offensive sometimes. Maybe they'd have a better delivery there with the press. So
I think the one thing that Apple keeps, it's been sitting on their haunches essentially with this whole thing between VR and even the camera. I feel like we haven't gotten a decent camera in a while. It's been like these micro upgrades, but it still doesn't do the same kind of quality you're seeing in the Androids now.
But they had a great camera to begin with, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I think what differentiates the two though is also the screen. So and what I've heard a lot of people do is take someone with an iPhone and send a picture to a Samsung device, and they're mm-hmm. like, wow, the camera is awesome.
Mm-hmm.
It's the screen displaying.
Oh.
Yeah, because they're using the OLED display, and they color tweak that display.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
So I've heard a lot of people that say it's actually not a lot of times the camera, it's the screen display mm-hmm. that's making it look phenomenal.
And that's the biggest thing, unless the Samsung just generally has, but that screen pops the way that iPhone screens don't.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And iPhone definitely leapt forward several years ago when they popped up to the Retina display. You're like, well, wow, that looks good. It's vibrant. It's amazing. And just Samsung, just like, you know, Samsung's gonna, and I know the displays currently, these are Samsung displays actually, aren't mm-hmm. they? So, but Samsung's gonna have the good stock for themselves first. Like,
well, that, and I think that there's some certain technology like Force Touch, and there's some other technology that they're leveraging
mm-hmm.
that you can't do with OLED yet.
Right.
It's just like wireless charging. You can't do wireless charging through metal,
mm-hmm.
which is why Samsung actually went to a glass back
mm-hmm.
versus a metal back. So there's some give and take with when you want something specific.
Glass.
And it's when you
wireless charging is awesome.
And even the fast charging's really, really, awesome. Really good. I don't have one of the fast charging wireless ones. That's what kind of stinks.
I guess, and I've been poking around with that S6 that you gave me with the Gear VR, and it's not bad.
No, it's not bad at all.
It's a slick little phone, and it's growing on me as I'm kind of poking around with it. I still kind of wish, and I was even booted up the old Nexus 7 that I have, and I was like, I'd rather have that interface over here, just for commonality. Mm-hmm. I hate that I picked up two Android devices and they're different.
Completely.
You know, mm-hmm. Yeah, like completely different. You know, versus I have a Lenovo PC and an Asus PC over here, and they have Windows 10, and you know, it's basically the same thing, right? Mm-hmm. Like, there's a couple little apps, but they're mostly hidden. You know, mm-hmm. about like
download the Google Now launcher.
Mm-hmm.
That'll help,
and that'll get you to the Nexus.
That'll get you close.
That'll get you real
close. That's nice. There are options like that.
Yeah. I think Google understood that.
This is that thing that we've been hearing about for years, about Google bringing that commonality a little bit, right? Mm-hmm. So,
and I think that's why Google's going to go on, and I mean, we're here now. They're talking about building not a partnered Nexus device, but a device of their own.
More of a flagship, right?
Mm-hmm.
And while it breaks my heart to actually admit it, one place where Apple still does have it over everyone else is their ability to release updates. You know, John and I were talking about this earlier today. Mm-hmm. You know, his S6 got Marshmallow a month ago.
And it's been out since last October.
You know what I mean? That's a long time to go. You know?
And then the 6 Edge Plus and the Note just got it 2 weeks ago. So, I mean, it takes forever.
So that's a long time between those updates. And then, you know, the question will be next, will they even get, which it kills me, Nougat?
Nougat.
Why will they even get Nougat, you know, on those devices?
The worst name ever.
Because, yes, it is the worst name ever. Because normally, from what everything I've read and heard, because, you know, this is my first foray. Yes, I'm no longer a Windows Phone guy.
Well, you couldn't have done VR with a Windows Phone, that's for sure.
So I've moved, although, you know, I've moved. But, you know, you're lucky if you get one. From everything I've read, you get the next OS and that's it.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah, I'm hoping, when KitKat launched, a lot of companies went back and went pretty far back in their catalog. I'm thinking that Nougat's going to force that issue if you want to do Daydream and everything else.
That is, I don't know if you guys on IU, you don't see Ron just shaking his head like, nah, I don't think so.
Nougat.
And also, this Daydream thing with Google, it's going to be mostly new phones. I don't think there's going to be a lot of rollback.
That I don't know.
The specs on this thing were going to be very high. That I don't think there's, like, maybe the S7 Edge, maybe the latest iPhone, but I don't think a lot of things fit the tech specs for it even.
Well, and that's where it'll be interesting to see what those tech specs are. Are mm-hmm. they something that's not out yet, or are they 64-bit processor that everyone claimed they wouldn't need? How do they draw the line, and how does all that fit together? Because the other thing, I'm guessing you could do is you could really, when the device is inserted, do you really need to keep all of Google services running and all that stuff running in the background?
Right.
Or can you power that down? And that's something I even see on the Gear VR is there's still a little bit of a heat dissipation issue. I've never run into it, but I've heard people say they get the prompt to eject the device from the goggles.
I did notice it got warm.
Yeah, right away. It's real warm.
Right away. Quick. Remember, I even mentioned it when I plugged it in the front.
I'll start downloading like a 360 movie in the background and then go play something else. And it's like no time before I get the, hey, you need to cool off. You know, and again, I'm running the SDK, so I didn't know if that had anything to do with it. But is this just, it seems to always still happen. This is just a design flaw, it seems.
Yeah.
So, hey, phones get hot when you're processing, you know, a gun battle in the middle of space with multiple things coming at you and all this kind of stuff. So I do want to talk more about that, but you have a backup awesome thing, Krause, that you wanted to talk about real quick. And it looked interesting. I definitely want you to talk about it.
It's my Bluetooth headphones. Now I will freely admit, take this with a grain of salt, they are not a Beats replacement headphones, but if you would like a set of Bluetooth noise-canceling stereo headphones, they're MPow Wolverine, I believe.
Schnick, schnick.
And they work great. I got a link there. I noticed if you pick the gold version of them, they're actually a few dollars cheaper than the black ones.
Is this the $15 ones?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you switch between the colors, the price changes.
Yeah.
So
retails for $26.99 on here.
Yeah.
But no, that's awesome.
I found them on Android Central, does their daily deals.
Mm-hmm.
And it happened to be one, and I picked them up for $15, and they are well worth the $15, especially if you're a Port Authority bus rider like myself. if you don't like to hear the conversations going on,
you kind of need some good headphones.
Throw the noise canceling headphones in and put on your favorite podcast, and that just drifts away.
If you're on the New York City subway, I would not.
I'd be nervous about what people were doing around.
All right, let's make this distinction. This safety trip tip.
safety
you
trip.
You probably should not put on VR goggles on public transportation or in public. I was feeling a little exposed just sitting on my back porch at night trying them out.
Oh, really?
I just felt at risk. Not to mention I'm on like my porch where I could fall to my death. But you know, just kind of that. Yeah, I was sitting, so you know, okay. It's not like I'm doing HTC Vive on the back porch. You know, a story up like
right.
Like I'm just doing Job Simulator. Let me touch this button. Oh, I think I would not recommend that unless like they do the camera mode kind of thing, which I think they might be able to with the Samsung, to be honest.
Well, there is a camera on the front of the device.
Yeah, I thought I'd see something that you could like kick that on to see what's going on the other side. But I haven't figured it out on my end yet. So, yeah. But no, check them out. They're the MPow Wolverine Bluetooth 4.1 wireless sports headphones. I'm not reading all the rest of this.
Yeah.
But they're up on Amazon and they're pretty cheap. $15. That's not bad for Bluetooth.
What's the battery life?
I get a few days of bus rides.
Wow.
So I get at least two commutes before it's telling me to plug them in. That's for there and back.
Official line is up to 8 hours of continuous talk music time and 175 of standby.
Yeah.
So in comparison.
Yeah. They work, they do. I really like them.
All
right. Well, and you get them off the link, right? And
go hit the Amazon thing over on our awesomecast.net and look these up from there. And I don't know, maybe I'll start putting the affiliate links back in the post again. And we'll toss that in there. We haven't had something like that for a bit. So, Katie,
hi.
What is your awesome thing of the week?
It's more awesome and not techie at all.
That's fine.
This is all geek time here. So I was at Hallmark. This is a catalog. And I didn't know that this was a thing, and I don't know if this is a new thing, but it's the Dream Book, and it's the ornaments. Yeah. And there are some amazing, amazing ornaments coming out this year. If you are into geeky things, I have Rainbow Bright. There is a Rainbow Bright coming out of Hello Kitty, of course. I have special things for everybody in this catalog.
The Death Star.
Did you see? I don't trump your awesome thing.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Me. I'm all excited.
I know. It's okay. You can be excited. I have like two in here for Chilla, actually.
Christmas can't come fast enough.
We have He-Man, Grimlock, which I'm freaking losing my mind over. It's a freaking Grimlock ornament.
Oh, that's awesome.
Friends at home, look at that.
Oh, wow.
Losing my mind. There's also Gem.
It actually kind of looks like Grimlock, too. Yeah,
it's pretty dang amazing. If you like the Christmas story, that's there. There's a Muppets bus.
Nice.
Who knew they had a catalog?
This is brand new to me. There's Aliens, there's Walking Dead, there's Assassin's Creed. Look at that. You can have your Assassin's Creed guy on your tree. And then this is what Chilla is talking about. Now, I'm going to have to find some video on this because I actually want to see this.
Remote-controlled
powered Death Star that changes color to music.
Oh, that will be on my tree.
Is that a tree topper?
Yes. Yeah, Star Wars main title in the Imperial March.
Hold on a second.
Yeah, you have to find this. It's press the button on the remote control to see the Death Star illuminate in a synchronized light show with the music from Star Wars. Insane. It's $100, but I love it. It's beautiful. Actually, if you would have saw my tree last year, I had this little gimpy thing on top. But there are a ton of Star Wars on here, too.
X-Wing. Yes.
There's Iron Man.
Chilla!
Sorry.
Chilla!
He can't help it!
I can't help it!
He's geeking out to your awesome thing of the week. That's how awesome it is.
There is a Rogue One ornament coming out.
Alright, here is the tree topper. So let's see what this looks like.
Tree topper.
We're
gonna go back to the Death Star. We're just gonna look at the Death Star. I'm trapped in your dream. Changes color remote control music. That's all you need to know. And, okay, so we're going to redo Chilla's Iron Man for Chilla. So pretty much anything you can imagine. Like, it's fantastic. I'm so excited because I have never seen a catalog of all these before because it's always the excitement of walking in the Hallmark store and going, hey, I didn't see that. This is cool. I'm excited. But it's really, really cool because in the middle is this thing called paper. And you can order these in advance. So no going to darn store
cheating.
And dealing with people. You take this little form here and you go back to your Hallmark, which mine happens to be in the Captain Ingram Shopping Center, and you can order them, and you'll be getting them a little bit earlier than everybody else, probably, because you're not fighting with each other. And they're actually pretty reasonably priced. Like, Grimlock's $16.
The Death Star is $99.95, by the way.
Yeah, that's not the one that's so reasonably priced.
Yeah, there it is there on the webpage as well. And it looks like, so this is what it turns red and blue. I love the super angry Death Star red, that's going on there. So
we actually, the funny, I know that book forward and backwards. And the reason that I can say like, oh, this and this and this because we used it to teach Christopher about like different types of things like cars and planes, like the Martin the Lockheed Martin page towards the back right before the after the football players with the black plane and the red plane.
Yeah.
And then the trains next to it. Like, we used this entire book to teach him about like different stuff that we didn't have pictures of, or
that's amazing.
Instead of looking up things individually, we actually used that book. And he now reads that book every night before he goes to bed.
Oh, I love it so much. Okay,
so it also doubles as a kid's book.
Nice.
And things. Yeah, so that, okay. There's a tractor. There's a John Deere tractor, riding lawnmower.
Two Harley Davidsons.
Wait, oh no, this is a Chilla quiz?
No, it's about the tractor.
No, I just feel like I'm going to have to turn over right now. On page number,
yeah.
Which cartoon character appears on?
We use it to teach them about football, baseball, hockey.
Oh, that's
they have all the different balls on the one page.
That's great.
That's fantastic. See, we just need awesome.
But the problem is now I want to order everything out of it.
I wanted there's just so many really, really cool things in there, and that's gonna be a problem. I'm just impressed also by all the things that are motorized now, and things that play music and light up, and that's fun too.
All right, check that out. So where can they can just pick that up at the store?
Yeah, go to your Hallmark store. They should have it, and it's free. So everybody's getting ornaments.
Awesome. Chilla, what's your awesome thing?
So my awesome thing of the week is I've been switching back and forth between my MacBook and my Surface 3 frequently for a project for work.
Okay.
And if you've seen the trackpad on a Surface 3, it's like the size of your thumbnail.
It's small.
So moving and navigating with it is pain. And I was looking for a mouse that was easily worked between the two. So I found this Logitech Ultrathin mouse, and I actually, oddly enough, had one laying around the house. But it actually has a switch on it, so it'll Bluetooth sync. It actually reminds me of the Magic Mouse, where you kind of tap left and tap right side. It just knows which side of the mouse you're tapping on.
Yeah, there's no actual button.
For different things. And then it actually does have some feedback to it from a click perspective. Ooh. But there's no separation of the buttons. You can actually touch on it and it scrolls. It's nice and small and compact. It's battery powered. But what I thought was really cool is there's a switch on the bottom. 1 and 2. It's first device and second device that you paired with. Nice. So I could literally have both devices sitting powered up and going, and I want to switch from this device to that. I can just flip the switch on the bottom.
Jeez.
And it pairs instantly to the other device. Super nice for if you have a device that you don't like the trackpad or you don't like the way the mouse works, and all your devices have Bluetooth. This is a lifesaver. The only thing that I don't like about it is, and I haven't had a problem with it, but the charge port, it's rechargeable, it doesn't use batteries. The charge port's on the bottom. I wish they would have somehow put it on the top so I could have recharged it while I was using it. I have had that happen with my Apple trackpad on occasion, where I want to charge it while I use it. And since the charge port's on the front of it, I can do that. But I'm actually, because I've gotten so much use out of this and like it so much, I'm actually thinking about their MX Master, which I also included a link in the Awesome Thing of the Week. And that device, I think, allows you to connect up to 4 or 5 devices.
Oh, wow. And what is this?
And it actually, the MX Master has both the USB dongle, if you don't have Bluetooth, for the Logitech Unified technology, and then it also does Bluetooth and charges over USB. So sorry, what were you going to ask?
Nice. Oh, because this is kind of a different looking mouse. I don't know how to describe this for those on audio.
Which, the thin one or the...
The MX Master. The
MX Master, I look at it as it's like a... Where you would normally put your thumb on the mouse, there's an extra piece, like a peninsula that juts out.
So it's like your hand can kind of rest on the device a little bit more.
And I'm guessing there's some buttons underneath there, because I know the scroll wheel's over there as well. Mm-hmm. So there's an additional scroll left to right and scroll up and down in the center of the mouse. So
awesome.
I'm interested in trying this out. As long as I continue to get good use out of this, I may put this off for a while. But I do sometimes have to carry 3 and 4 devices.
Mm-hmm.
So this would definitely be nice.
I love the eye roll from Krause.
Yeah.
Well,
you can, I mean,
I have to.
This is where we do our weekly disclaimer. Chilla is not regular people.
No, he is not.
Not the use case of regular people.
He admitted last week he's an Android.
But that's what I was going to get to. So I'm sure.
What, the Android?
I'm sure this only works with. It says that it only works with Windows and Mac, but I would be willing to bet that you could pair it to an Android device.
Probably.
Which would be interesting as a carry along with your Oculus Rift.
With an Oculus.
Ooh.
That is a very interesting.
Is there a lot of mouse support?
I don't know.
I wasn't aware of
mouse support. There's gamepad support, so I'm guessing you're going to at least get some direction and
at least clicks. Left, right, up, and down. Yeah.
Because
I've used the mouse frequently with Android, especially when I had my Zoom tablet,
because
they actually had a keyboard that had a slide-out trackpad. And you could use that in almost like kind of in a laptop configuration.
Mm-hmm.
And the mouse support was great. And since it's supported with Android out of the box, I'm guessing it's probably pretty easy to make work.
Awesome. You were talking about the kind of the charge cord. Small mini story here, and we'll get back to awesome things. But the Apple TV remote started dying, and like the day before, I had the thought in my head. I was like, how do I change batteries in this thing? And then Missy was like, hey, this thing is not reactive. Like, how do we charge it? And I'm like, wait, how do we charge it? Mm-hmm. And like, I forgot.
Was it the new Apple TV?
Yeah, it's a new Apple TV remote. And I completely forgot it was like the new Apple devices. And I'm like, wait a minute. There should have been a USB that came with this. Wait a minute. And I looked, tucked behind my Apple TV was an unused iPhone cord, basically. lightning cord. And I was just so happy with myself that I had tucked that away from myself and not put it in circulation with my with my phones or anything. By the way, then I put it in my pocket and it's suitably lost. But anyways, but still, and it was, you know, I probably gave it like a half an hour charge and it was good to go. They don't need a lot. So
the game controller that I got is actually uses the Lightning.
Really?
It's perfect.
Really?
And that one works with the Mac and Apple TV and a couple other. I didn't try pairing it yet with Oculus.
Yeah, the one I got was very specifically Android, I thought. I haven't tried it with the Apple TV. I'm just happy I was working with the Oculus. So yeah, it's worked out pretty well. All right, my awesome thing, as we discussed, I have Chilla's old SDK Gear VR, so I'm in the VR land as well. I don't mind Chilla's hand-me-downs at all. So
I'm still rocking the Google Glass from time to time.
Yes he is. So there you go, it goes both ways. But of course, you know, I'm going to hit up a lot of the gaming that's going to happen out there, and I picked up a couple of things. I picked up a couple more games while there was a sale that ends I think today on the Oculus store. So, and again, games aren't that much. Like the biggest game I saw was like $10, and most of them were on sale, so we had a pretty good deal on things. There were two that I kind of had a chance to get into. I want to try to find some video of this one. I know there's like Eve Valkyrie is a game that's going around for like Oculus Rift and everything. But this is, I think, a lower end version of it. It's called Eve Gunjack. And it's kind of they stick you out. Think the gunner in the bottom of the Millennium Falcon a little bit. But they stick you outside of the ship, and there's ships coming at you. You're moving your head. This is great with a game controller. To be able to shoot and be able to, you know, switch to other rockets and things like that. It was a pretty cool experience and pretty cool, like, futuristic, you know, space setting and a lot of fun on the Gear VR. The other one I picked up was Land's End. When I found out that was from the creators of Monument Valley, I didn't even look at what kind of game it was, because I had so much fun with Monument Valley. It was a game that was like $5, you know, which is rare these days that it's like, hey, this is going to be $5 and it's going to be this long and that's it, right? And I had a blast with that. This one is kind of like Monument Valley meets like Myst a little bit. It's in 3D. It's interesting. You're on these islands for the most part at the beginning of the game. I'm on the third level. And there's like 5 levels on this thing. Like, it's not a long game. You're going to blow right through this if you have, you know, a couple hours to spare at this point. But really cool to be on that, you know, in that world and solving these puzzles. And the puzzles aren't terribly hard or anything like that. Just kind of an interesting experience as you roll through like caves and islands and everything. And you start like kind of building blocks, like, I guess, with your mind in this thing. It's a lot of fun. The moving around is taken care of with you kind of look at points and move to the next point. So again, it's kind of that missed point to point to point kind of gameplay to it a little bit. Again, I had a blast with that. It's called Land's End. No, not the clothing company. So those are the couple that I've gotten into so far on there. The most nauseating thing I played was Temple Run. Holy hell. that was rough. And I even got my wife to get into it, and she had a problem. There's some kind of one that I think was loaded on there that's kind of like this mystery game where you're in a room full of people and you're trying to figure out who murdered somebody. Is it like their drink was poisoned? And it's like, you know, it feels like you're kind of in Assassin's Creed a little bit, but you're just kind of roaming around and finding clues. Mm-hmm. She said that's actually the one that nauseated her the most, because like just the moving from point to point a bit. Mm-hmm. And she can't do 3D movies.
Gives her headaches.
So I was really worried, and I've been trying to get her to try. I really wanted her to try the Vive, for instance, because I figured that would be the best case scenario since it's the best one. Mm-hmm. And again, that's one of those things where as you get better hardware, it's gonna, you know, you're gonna get less of that because it's gonna sink a little better and not give you that nauseous feeling, hopefully. So that's it. Land's End, Eve Gunjack, and there's a lot of fun stuff there. So friend me, Sorgatron Krause, over there, and we'll play some recommendations. Well,
this takes place in the Eve universe.
Okay.
So he was a big Eve online player.
I played Eve years ago.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
So that's so very interesting. I'll have to check that out for sure.
Yeah, because it says virtual reality gaming experience set in a sprawling EVE universe.
Okay.
So it'll be interesting to see if they can tie that in with a lot of their other
games. Right, and it looks like kind of a dip your toe into the universe kind of thing. It's very focused on one thing from what I'm seeing. So yeah, and the Valkyrie I think is doing like a broader thing because you're actually in a ship flying around. So, and I kind of expect these are going to be truncated experiences a little bit, you know, versus what we can do on a full blown Oculus Rift. But I think again, this is like, you know, gaming on the iPhone, you know, which it really is because you're in a phone on your headset. So, so it'll be interesting to see what happens there. All right. Well, let us know your awesome things of the week at AwesomeCast on the Twitter. Hit us up or join us here live in the chat room, live.sorgatronmedia.com. Let's touch bits. Hey, so, you know how we got so many people in the studio that I had to go hook up some new mics and stuff to tonight? What did you say about being in the studio tonight, Katie?
I don't know. Something about pizza.
Yeah, pizza. From our good friend Slice on Broadway, supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with pepperoni pizza. There's some in there still, I think.
There better be, or I'm going to just leave right now. Flip table buyout.
Our good friends hanging out. And hey, they have a gonzo pie down there, so go check that out. They're in Beachview, right along the tracks here on Broadway, hence the name. Down on Main Street in Carrick, Carnegie, PA, as well as down at the ballpark, PNC Park, home of the Pittsburgh Pirates. And I actually got to get down there with Doug last week after social media day, and we ran into Rico. I haven't talked to him for a good while, the owner of Slice on Broadway, the entire chain, and got to talk with him about the new location and everything. A really cool that they have that going on, and you can grab some if you're on the North Shore or at the Pirates games. So go check them out, sliceonbroadway.com, PGH_slice on the Twitter, as well as looking at Slice on Broadway on the Facebook and the Instagram, and be hungry too. Let them know the awesome cast sent ya. All right, thank you to them. All right, let's get into, so we really kind of already had our VR talk for the night, so we have a few other things up here. I haven't seen one all. Krause, you were talking about Google Project Fi was interesting you.
Yeah, I just, the idea, you know, I'm a Verizon person.
Good. Well, I live tomorrow your prices will be going up.
Yes, I live, breathe, and die Verizon. You know, they've got me at the home. And
has Verizon like become like the cable company? By the way, your prices are going up.
There was an article today about how they feel like they've acquired enough with their data cap change and their price changes. They feel like they've acquired enough customers to now re-raise their prices. I was like, what? Really?
Yeah.
What? That was the did they say that?
Well, that's, I don't know if that's that probably was kind of like the summary.
The subtext.
Yeah.
Yeah. When they're going to this new small, medium, large, extra large, extra, extra large plan. But,
like Slice on Broadway?
Yes. Like, just like Slice.
Well, here's the other thing. So this I didn't notice. So I have Verizon Fios, which I understand got bought by somebody. Is that correct?
Oh, I didn't hear about that.
I heard somebody in a podcast in the past mentioned about how Frontier was buying Verizon Fios. I have not heard of this yet. But I logged in to pay my bill, and I noticed that there is a, hey, this is how much data you're using. Now, for me, I was just maxed out on everything, because there is like this many gigabits, and they like topped out on 175, and I'm just over, and they just stopped and said, hey, you're over this. Devices, it said I'm definitely at 10 plus devices.
Well, go figure.
Yeah. What are you talking about?
I don't know what you're talking about here. I thought it was interesting that they had a visual look at that. And again, enticing me, hey, maybe you should get a larger plan. You should have the quantum plan or whatever. I'm at 25 up and down. It seems to be plenty for what we do here, you know, more or less. Yeah, we use a lot here on Tuesday nights, but other than that, it's just me and my wife, you know. So we can only stream so much Netflix at one time.
Let me know how that goes for you when you start setting up multiple security cameras.
In here?
Are you going to set any up at the house, or are they just for
I'm going to do some here at the house, but it's going to be very low bandwidth. It's going to be movement based, and so it's only going to upload to like Dropbox like whenever something actually happens.
When something happens, okay.
Like that's what I've been doing so far with SiteHound. Okay. I just want to move that down to a smaller package so I can put it in more places. And I'm going to actually put a security cam. Right now I'm running like one on the front. I'm giving away my security plan, but I'm going to put one at the back door here, mm-hmm. you know, coming into the studio. I'm going to put one, you know, hopefully on the back porch and a couple up front so I can take a look at a couple things that are going on out there because there's so much activity out on the street, just to be sure. And I'm glad now that I'm looking into this because there's been, you know, car break-ins just two streets back. So, you know, it makes sense mm-hmm. to be able to do that kind of thing. And, of course, for the new studio and everything, I want to have multiple there. And we'll probably bump up the internet when we get there. But anyways, what the hell was the point of the story?
Verizon.
Project Fi.
And Fi.
Let's go back around to that instead of complaining about Verizon.
Fi, their deal is, if you don't know, if you're not aware, you pay $20 a month for unlimited phone calls, texting, and then it's $10 per gigabyte of data. And so this is a prepaid plan. So the way they described it in the article was you pay your $20, and then if you say, okay, I'm going to use 2 gig of data, mm-hmm. you pay them $20. But, oh, by the way, if you only use a gig and a half,
you're all good.
You get that back, yeah. You know, or you get some of it back, or it goes towards the next month's bill or something like that. Now, they did mention that right now it's, although John seems to think you can get your hands on the SIM, but it looks like right now it's for the Nexus 6P, the Nexus 5, or the Nexus 6.
So I think something software needs to be on the phone for it to be supported. Mm-hmm. Because remember, this is dealing with the Sprint network, the T-Mobile network.
And Wi-Fi,
which Sprint and T-Mobile are two different technologies last I knew. Yes. And Wi-Fi. So you need something.
CDMA and GSM.
You need something to be smart enough to hand off against three different technologies. Sure. Now, our friend Will, DJ Lunchbox, just on the Comcast that we released last week in the stream, he's been using this, and he's telling me he loves it. He says he's saving a ton of money. It makes sense. And now I will, you know, I always say, oh, maybe I'll go to one of these cheaper plans. Then I look at the coverage map and realize it's not going to work when I'm out in the middle of the desert mm-hmm. on a shoot. So it doesn't work for me. Now, he's somebody that goes to, where does he live now? Manaca, and comes into Pittsburgh.
Yeah.
He's okay. He's fine. He's not going out into the cut and expecting that thing to work on a regular basis, you know. So that works for him. It doesn't work for me on my shoots. So I think for people that are very city-based, go for it, man. Mm-hmm. You know, if you can get that phone, if you can get one supported once, and I'm sure this is going to roll out to more.
And I think you also have to be not consuming a ton of data.
Right, because you pay for it.
$10 a gig.
Does it max out? Because I've heard people, some of those like super high-end phone-using people on some podcasts talking about how, hey, I think like Verizon doesn't let them get more than X plan. And they're like, I just want to use all the data I want. I will pay for it, no problem.
I didn't hear that it would cap out. I heard that it would, you get to a point where they throttle you.
On Fi?
Not on Fi.
On Verizon.
Well, yeah. I think it's the throttle was the problem, right? Yeah. So I'm wondering if these guys do something. I'm like, let me use all the data I want if I'm willing to pay for it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know what I mean? If you're going to pony up the money, then, you know, so be it.
We're paying a pretty penny for our phone service right now. We have 5 lines, probably not the biggest part of it, but we also have like 30 gigs of data plus rollover because we got that deal a couple mm-hmm. years ago, right? And it doesn't take any sense for us to drop. We're pulling, like on average, my wife and I are pulling 6 gigs a month on these things.
Well, my wife tells me all the time that my Verizon bill is a luxury car payment a month.
It is. Probably. Oh, it is. Mm-hmm. Oh, absolutely.
Because you got everything. You have.
Yeah, because I have Fios. I have the home phone. I have the cable.
Are you paying for? Is it the Edge plan for the phone? So you're still paying for that? Because we're paying for 2 iPhones on ours on top of everything.
No, I don't
else.
Have any of the Edge plans
so,
yet.
Yeah. I was
next upgrade.
I was looking at like a good check came in. I was like, maybe I should just pay off my phone now. You know, just take care of it. You know. But no, but hey, that's the price of being mobile. And there are other options. Again, you know, some people have different lifestyles that they can have that cheaper plan and be okay and do all the things they want to do, you know?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, she tells me all the time I could be driving a Hummer for what I pay Verizon.
I can believe it.
No, but I could be driving
it. You could drive it down the block and then back and then down and then back and then you're done.
All right.
For all the money they're making, you'd think they'd be able to push out an Android update on occasionally.
Yeah, you think. Yeah.
You'd think. No, they're too busy buying AOL. That's where your money's going.
Who's buying AOL?
Didn't they buy AOL?
Verizon?
Who bought AOL?
Wait a minute. Did they buy? Yeah. They bought somebody, yeah.
I thought they bought a couple of people.
Yeah.
So.
I think you're right.
Yeah. Yeah. They bought like whoever has Engadget or something, I think. Yeah. Which I think was the old AOL. So, there you go. Coming back. You're still paying for AOL in 2016. Congratulations. Really? Well, so am I, so.
That's depressing.
That is really depressing. AOL won't go away, man. Also to blame partially for the downfall of WCW in my eyes. That's another podcast, though. All right, we talked about Android fragmentation hindering Android VR adoption a little bit, I suppose.
Yeah.
We really did get into that. BlackBerry OS. I was hearing about this. So Chilla, BlackBerry OS is going away.
So BlackBerry, the classic smartphone.
Right.
And which is running, I think, prior to BB10.
And now OS. This, they have basically migrated to be an Android phone now.
Well, no, I'm hearing that they're still going to support the Q10, the Z10, the Z30, and the Passport. It's just the old school classic that, oddly enough, right before this came out, the Senate, was it?
Some government body
just said, we're leaving BlackBerry as the standard, and you get a
Samsung.
It was weird. It was the Samsung Galaxy, I think it was S5.
What?
Or the iPhone 5SE. Both 16 gig devices.
Wow.
Those are your government issued.
Well, if the FBI can't get into the one, then it's safe, right? So, or can it?
Dun dun
dun dun dun dun dun.
But it was interesting because the article does go in and talk about, you know, BlackBerry and their move to the Priv and Android devices, and will they come out with another Android device? They didn't put it out of the realm of possibility that they'll have another flagship keyboard type device like the Priv, where it's maybe not even a slider. But then they also went in to talk about market leadership, and BlackBerry's accounted for 0.2% of worldwide sales in Q1. Android phones represented 84% of all purchased devices. The interesting thing is when you look at the number being that large, Samsung accounts for the largest share of devices at 23%, and Apple was close behind them with 14.8%. So even on a quarter where Apple didn't have a device that was launched, and it was at two quarters after the 6S and 6S Plus. They're still right behind Samsung, and Samsung obviously had the S7 launch. So it's interesting to see where they're everyone's falling.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously Microsoft wasn't even listed in this. Sorry.
It's okay. Rest in peace.
he's like goodbye.
It's killing them all off. All right. Katie, did you have anything in here you wanted to touch on?
Nope, I just want to
talk
about
you want to talk about your stuff.
Also, if you need a box set of the Star Wars trilogy, the Craft in Noblestown Road, the thrift store down there has a set. Nice. I was down there today and did everything in my power not to buy it, considering that's what I'm currently stockpiling. I think it's going to be currency in the near future.
Apparently.
VHS?
Star Wars VHS.
I'm not sure who this is in the chat room, but if you guys are on video, you're seeing the plight that's happening. But thank you to whoever made the picture. Gonzo isn't a mic stand. Support our Patreon. Godzilla in our chat. Fantastic.
We need help.
Help. That might be going on our Patreon page. So meanwhile, Katie is dropping Grimlock gifts on Twitter, it seems.
Yes. Because I Snapchatted the Snapchat story of my video of what ornaments I wanted. Nice. I don't know what this says about me.
That's going to be the new way to send your list to Santa.
Or if you can fit it in a Snapchat video, you can have it. Yes. Because mm-hmm. it took me about 10 tries to get it all in there while holding down the button and flipping.
Right, because you got to, what's the time limit?
10 seconds.
Yeah.
Yeah.
10 seconds.
I want a lot of ornaments. That's hard.
So you figured out Snapchat.
Yes, I understand the Snapchat.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. I'm hip.
You are hip.
She's hip.
She has zombies. She has zombies. She has old-timey trips in Michigan and all kinds of fun stuff.
I'm going to go home and take a picture of my... I got a new TV stand. So I have my TV, VCR, DVD player combo and my record player on my TV stand. And I'm just going to go put the Polaroid filter on my Snap or my Instagram on there and just be like, is this old picture or new picture? I'm just gonna start taking pictures of things around my house and different filters, and you just tell me if this is a picture from before or a picture from my current house.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Krause, tell me about veterans and VR.
Well, actually, my wife found this on the Today Show.
Okay, so to Mrs. Krause.
Yes. So,
Is she also a crazy Krause?
No, it was fun. Well, no, she's still Fleming, but we won't go there. But we are married. But it was funny because she recognized from the pictures I told her that I had ordered this device.
Wait. Are you talking about? Hold on. Are you talking about? Let me find you this picture right here of this guy with like just loving his Gear VR in his
hands. So she recognized the fact that the thing during the video he actually had it on his head. And she said, I was watching the Today Show this morning and I recorded for you because they had your headset on this guy. And so I went back and watched it. And it turns out this gentleman, I believe, was 90 years old. And he's never, obviously fought in World War II, but he's never physically been able to go to the World War II Memorial in Washington, D.C., Mm-hmm. So there's a project going on, a fund or something that they're trying to get to all these vets to let them experience, the Veterans Memorial through VR. And it's incredible. If you take a minute to watch the video while he has the headset on, you can actually see him physically reacting to the stuff that he's seeing in this memorial, and it was just very cool. And it's just like, I thought, how amazing is that? Because they said, I guess based on whatever his health problems are, he can't travel that kind of distance that it would take and everything to get him there. And this technology is allowing him to actually go and visit this memorial, for the first time. And I just thought it was really cool.
Jeez, I hope they're not putting them in that vibe like that poor girl there crawling on the floor.
Yeah, well, they were experiencing multiple different types of VR. They get back to him here eventually.
I think that's one of the biggest things for the VR is to be able to experience things that you wouldn't be able to, whether it be from a disability or from an income perspective or whatever. I think that's the game changer for where this really fits in.
And they're even playing with a little bit of the 360 cameras like we have been around here. So I think that's really cool. That was one of the early things was like somebody had a Oculus SDK and they were taking their grandma to Paris.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Even I think early Google Glass stuff was doing that street view kind of thing and say, look, you can walk around and we'll put this on, somebody that can't get there and be able to experience that. I think that's the biggest thing. Everybody's worried about us getting lost in these things, but they forget about how much of a utility this can be and how much this can open up, for options like this in the long run. And that's why we're excited about it. That's why Crossover there is like, I don't know why I want this yet, but I'm going to find out.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
And I think that's the exciting part. And again, you're not investing like $2,000 in order to do this. You have the hardware. You just needed the case.
Yeah.
All that thing is that you bought is a fancy case for your phone.
Yes.
Yes.
And a whole bunch of plastic
that you please don't wear on the bus.
Yes.
So, and that's awesome. That's awesome. We'll see kind of where that goes from here. So, all right. Also from this lineup, anything else you guys want to hit on before we get out of here? We got a few stories kind of still hanging out over here.
I was surprised to see that Netflix is coming to Comcast boxes. Like that.
What?
That was like the big thing for them and point of contention. Where, I mean, they're throttling Netflix. They're saying, you know, we don't want people pretty much using Netflix. And then they tried to partner with them to get Orange Is the New Black. And I think they got House of Cards on demand. And now they're actually going to add a Netflix app to all the Xbox boxes.
Wow, money. I was like, well, I guess you guys are big enough. We got to treat you like we do HBO. We want a piece of this pie.
I was just
so
say,
that people are like, I don't need Comcast. Because I think a lot of people don't realize. Like I know most. Let's say there was a story that we had that we didn't talk about last week that was like half of America is watching video on demand, basically, right. Netflix and whatever. I think, but still, that other half doesn't know it's an option. You know, and if you just put that button there and be like, oh, that's that Netflix I heard about. And, oh, I can just hit a button and get it on my Comcast bill and make it convenient.
Yeah.
Well, I've heard a couple of people, and I think it was my stepmom, too. My sister got a new TV, and her TV has a Netflix button because it's built in as an app TV. Yeah. And she just thinks that's the most amazing thing in the world.
Chilla, even though I know most of us here in the current time know what Netflix is, there are still people that don't.
There's the Nebraska people.
I'm going to Nebraska next year.
Oh yeah.
By the way, Pittsburgh, Nebraska.
Nebraska.
No, Pittsburgh, Kansas. Okay. And I think Nebraska, or was it? I think it's Nebraska. I don't know. I got to wait for my itinerary officially. But I saw that and I realized, oh no, I got to do a special report from Nebraska for AwesomeCast.
You need some 360 video coming out of Nebraska.
Exactly. 360 video. But yeah, no. I think that's I don't even know where we were. You know, we can experience Nebraska in 360 video, so we don't have to go there.
Wow.
Well, speaking of Netflix,
brought to you by the Nebraska Chamber of Commerce.
Visit Nebraska. We got nothing else to do. Chilla, tell me what's going on with CW. I think it's been interesting.
This is kind of a dovetail.
Have you seen my conversation about this on Facebook? Because I've been kind of like pissed/okay about this. Well, I've been dealing with my bundle of emotions in regards to this change that's happening.
Okay, so
this change in how I'm going to watch TV in by the end of the year, in the most vital parts of my television watching is going to be disrupted.
Because
what?
Because of CW? I haven't seen your
hold on. Posts. Tell your story and I'll fill you in.
So CW also in tandem today, I saw that as Netflix is announcing that, or as Comcast is announcing, hey, we're getting Netflix. The CW then announced that they are going, within 1 week of the end of a season, all their shows are then going to come to Netflix.
Oh, really? That's not what I read. What the hell? Okay, that's a problem. Well, you see what they're doing.
Netflix will stream CW shows a week after their season finale.
Okay.
So to me, the way I read this article was that the CW, as soon as Arrow's over, 1 week later, the entire back catalog for the season is going to be available on Netflix.
But you know what is not going to be available by the end of the year? That it's going to be available the next day on Hulu.
Oh.
What's that?
CW shows.
Oh, CW shows.
By the end of the year, CW shows are leaving Hulu. So we're not going to
leaving Hulu.
So
okay.
I can't watch my basically my Hulu subscription has been floated mostly on CW programming right now. So I thought that they were going to show new episodes 2 weeks after they aired. Was what I've been hearing. But this is the official line then?
That's what last month rumors began circulating. Those CW shows that were streaming on Hulu would make it to Netflix a lot faster. Well, those reports were accurate as a streaming service. Oh, upcoming 2016.
So this means, Chilla, we're going to work on Project Sorg's DVR.
So I have two extra tuners. If we can get an antenna up and running, you can DVR it to a computer.
That's entirely what I'm going to end up doing by at least the middle of next season, because I'm just done with this.
Well, because they're picking up Supergirl now, too.
Exactly. And I'm already watching Legends of Tomorrow, Arrow, Flash, and iZombie.
Well, there's going to be one next year. Next year, there's going to be a full crossover between Flash, Arrow, Legends of Tomorrow, Supergirl.
Oh, it's so good!
It's going to be a five night crossover.
This is my reward. This is my reward for sticking through 10 years of bull s on Smallville.
Yeah, you're gonna get a five nights back to back Arrow, Flash, Legends of Tomorrow, Supergirl.
More happens in a single episode of any of those shows in comic book fandom than an entire season of Smallville. Okay, yes. Plus we had a deal with Birds of Prey about 10 years ago.
I didn't see that.
Oh,
I
don't watch that. It's on CW Seed if you really want to. Although they'd also have the original Flash series on there too. I'm gonna go back and watch that. Watch the original Mark Hamill trickster stuff. But anyways, I'm done. So,
I don't know if you'll get them next. But now, if you have, so we can work on a DVR solution, or, and I don't know if they still do it, the CW app. It was a 1 week delay. Oh,
that's fine with me.
So it was a 1 week delay. The only thing I will warn you about the CW app is that they obviously didn't get a lot of people to purchase commercials.
Oh my God.
So it's the same commercial over and over.
So I was watching Supergirl via the CBS app because they, even though you don't, okay, if I buy All Access, I don't get the entire season of Supergirl. If I'm not on All Access, then maybe you get a week delay, but they let me watch like 6 episodes.
That's kind of how CW is.
That's it. What are you trying to do?
I don't think they understand themselves.
I really don't think they do. No. Because, and I'm kind of worried because they're going to have the new Star Trek in there. And from what I understand, it's going to be rolling episodes. I can't just watch the entire season whenever I decide to finally plunk down the money for it. So if I miss those first couple episodes, guess what? I'm not buying any of the rest of your season.
They have to put them somewhere.
They have to, yeah.
Because that's a online only.
Oh, right. Yeah, Star Trek, it's not coming to TV,
They're going
to
show, from my understanding, they're going to show the premiere episode on television, and then the rest are going to be on All Access for CBS.
Speaking of that, I just finished my Star Trek trifecta. I am through every series now on Netflix.
Wow.
Wow, that took some effort.
Yes. It took me a very long time. I'm talking Enterprise, Next Generation.
Deep Space Nine?
Deep Space Nine, and Voyager. Yes, I have seen them all on Netflix.
Holy crap. How long
it took recently? Long time. Months. And
now,
months
how,
and
much months. Of the, how much of that did you watch first run back in the day?
All of Enterprise, all of Next Gen, quarter of Deep Space Nine, and none of. I had kids by the time Voyager came around.
Oh, yeah. There you go.
Yeah.
I've once in a while I'll go back and watch some original Star Trek because, I mean, it's been so long.
Yeah, original's the only one I have.
And the animated series. All right, that's enough fun there. Katie, where can people find things that you're doing?
Oh, geez. Kate Dudders on the Twitter, Kate Marie PGH on the Instagram, Snapchat Dudzy with 2 Z's for whatever reason.
You doing something for Bicentennial this week?
Oh, gosh, yeah, I forgot about that. I will be in a Bicentennial parade. They're letting zombies in the parade. We'll have a horde of zombies there for Scarehouse, so that was really exciting. So you can see us there, wave. We like to take pictures. And I think that's it.
Where's the parade?
Downtown. It's the 200-year anniversary of Pittsburgh.
Yeah, I was looking. I was like, maybe I should do something for that.
Yeah.
Why not? We were talking about this last night at that fireworks thing. Wasn't the 250? Wasn't there a 250 anniversary recently for something?
I don't understand it either, because there was a 250 anniversary in the city of Pittsburgh.
Is there like an incorporation date and an actual founding date or maybe something?
That might be.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? When it was incorporated as the city of Pittsburgh versus...
Just another reason to have a party.
Yeah. You know, that's us. There's fireworks because, you know...
Yeah, because God knows Pittsburgh loves them.
This year they pushed the regatta. So instead of syncing it up with 4th of July, the regatta is back to the first week in August.
So we have another reason.
So it's going to rain?
More fireworks.
Right?
More fireworks.
Oh, no, that's the Arts Festival.
It's the Arts Festival.
Arts Festival rains every year.
Yeah, Pittsburgh marked its 250th birthday in, what year is this? 2008. Yeah, I'm not sure. We need to look into this. We need to investigate this.
Okay, Dudders, follow her Dudsy on the Snapchats for all the zombie mayhem that happens
with
the Scarehouse and Scarehouse podcast.
Mm-hmm.
John Chichilla, chillatech.net.
John Chichilla on the Facebook, Chilla on the Twitter. I feel like I need to be like Dudders now. Chilla579 on the Instagram. Chilla photo on the DeviantArts.
What are you on ICQ?
Oh my goodness.
I'm 9173258.
Let's go.
I think that's
376536. I think that's it. I think there might be an 8 in there.
Niner.
So sad I can't log into that anymore. I don't have my Mouse City account anymore. But and Crazy Krause. Crazy Krause on the Twitter. That is with the K's.
Yep. That's it.
Or incorporation as a city. 200 years.
Yes, we did it. So that's what it was. Okay.
Go back to Krause.
Happy We Filed Our Paperwork Day, everybody.
Yay! 200 years, though. It's feet.
It's been a while.
Wow. Yeah. Yeah. A lot of Pittsburgh. I'm at Sorgatron, Sorgatron.com, SorgatronMedia.com. A lot of stuff going on all over the place. You can go check out Sawtooth Willie, where Sawtooth Willie encountered the furries at Anthrocon, and there's about 2 more weeks of that. And then we have something very, very special over at Sawtooth Willie. So go look them up on YouTube and Facebook or over at SorgatronMedia.com. We also have a special message we got to encounter. So a lot of Pittsburghers listen to this. Bill Cardell, Chili Billy of the old Chiller Theater, and of course Studio Wrestling. We got to actually sit down with him on a documentary project. We've been in the works for a little bit here, and of course he was diagnosed with cancer, and his daughter actually gave said, hey everybody, write him in some letters, give him some well wishes to help him through this and everything. And I know there's a lot of older fans of Studio Wrestling that grew up on him over the years, and I think it'd be really cool. I just wanted to help do our part to get the word out there. So we have a video over at Sorgatron Media's Facebook and YouTube page and the website talking about our experience with him, and a little message from our interview. Actually, it was a nice capper for his career that we definitely intended to use in the documentary itself. Really, it was kind of our first choice for the documentary closer, to be honest. But I thought it was a great message to his fans. So go check that out as well, SorgatronMedia.com, and all of our social media and video outlets too. Check out everything AwesomeCast.net. No interview coming up this week, but check out all the great stuff, awesome chats and everything over there. Sign up and subscribe wherever you would like to support us, patreon.com/awesomecast. Thank you, everybody that's joined us, live.sorgatronmedia.com, including Godzilla, which I think is my wife, actually. I don't know. It said it's the dog. I don't think the dog's that good at Photoshop. So, Juggler John, Hot Wheels, and so many more joining us throughout the evening and talking tech with us and having help tonight. Thank you, everybody, for joining us. Thank you. You have been our awesome audience. Have an awesome week. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at SorgatronMedia.com.